So welcome to Rolly Pulse, brought to you by Rolly Books. And it is a matter of great happiness that we are celebrating 223rd birth anniversary of our favorite poet Ghalib, with two remarkable writers and with two beautiful writers, Rana Safavi and Marianne Molteno. It is always exciting to get to interact with Rana Safavi, who glides from one exciting project to another and gives us all a feeling, or rather a complex, that this is life, which we don't have. Her passion for shared culture and history inspires us all in many ways, and her keen interest in poetry is obvious from her Shire platform, which was established in 2011 and has around 25,000 persons daily following their love for Urdu poetry through her platform. And it is really an honor to interact with Marianne Molteno, who is a very sensitive writer, a humanitarian activist, a novelist, and now editor, and much more. Marianne Molteno has been writing beautiful stories of empathy and compassion for nearly a quarter of a century, getting inspiration and stimulus from very diverse cultures and situations. Marianne is truly a global writer activist, because her writings are rooted in so many very different places like Somalia, Tajikistan, Isles of Scilly, South Africa, Swaziland, Pakistan, India, you name a country, and she must have written something about that. But this is really the tip of her creative iceberg. If I borrow an expression from one of her own books, her creative journey is without a map, really. We Indians are lucky that a writer of her sensitivity and sensibility decided, for some strange twist of fate, to devote her creative energies to Urdu poetry and to the ideas and ideals of our greatest icon, our favorite Mirza Ghalib, the Bard of Delhi. Mirza Ghalib had a few European shagirds before the tragedy of 1857 changed everything. Had he been living today, I'm sure among all his shagirds, he would appreciate his British eklavya most. And his British eklavya was none other than Ralph Russell. Marianne Molteno closely worked with Ralph, who was a very gifted and charming scholar. And his latest book, this book, is basically her book. The name is The Famous Ghalib, The Sound of My Moving Pen. It is a fascinating book. And with growing interest in Ghalib and his poetry, this is a must-have book for people who know something about Ghalib but don't know the Urdu script. And this book is also for people like me and Rana Safavi, who assume, or rather who think, that we know a thing or two about Ghalib, but Ralph Russell's brilliant nazar dazzles us always with a fresh perspective. And that creative surprise is always so thrilling and illuminating. So let me ask Rana Safavi, what exactly is so illuminating and thrilling in this book of magic? Well, the magic of poetry. Rana.
Thank you, Danish, so much for this lovely introduction to the, not only to the book, to Ghalib, and to Ralph Russell, and to us. Ghalib, of course, is somebody who's known to everybody. And whether they know Urdu or not, they definitely know that about Mirza Ghalib, one of the greatest poets of Urdu and, of course, Persian. But to understand the nuances of Ghalib is not easy. Ghalib wrote very complex verses, and to understand the metaphysical aspects of it, to understand the allusions, the symbolism, you need help. For if you are a newcomer to this world of poetry, but you may have heard the various singers singing his ghazals, and so are very enamored by the poetry. And that is where people like Ralph Russell have helped. His book, I've read other books of his. This is not the first book that I've read, The Moving Pen. And I love the way he writes very simply and explains and makes Ghalib come life for us. And even if we go to Ghalib's Haveli, the first thing that meets us is a quote by Ralph Russell that had Ghalib been writing in English, he would have been as famous as Shakespeare. Ralph Russell is him in himself an institution, one of the, or in fact, the best scholar of Ghalib and Urdu poetry in the West. And so to read his book, to be able to participate in a program on a book by him, published by Rowley, is indeed an honor.
Yes, yes, yes. Thank you. Thank you, Rana. And it is said that Ralph Russell was almost like Ghalib in his personal life also, as he was absolutely free from you know, any kind of prejudice. He believed in, he believed profoundly in equality between people of all races, religions, genders, and ages. And he had a great sense of humor and loved enjoyment of, you know, simple things like aam and kebabs and of course wine. So Marian, do you think that philosophically also Ralph Russell had a similar worldview like Ghalib, and whether any such reflection is there in this book?
Well, again, thank you very much for such a lovely introduction. Before I answer, I should just say that you praised me too highly for my knowledge of Ghalib. It's Ralph that had the knowledge of Ghalib, and I was simply his editor and assistant. I learned from him. Everything I know, I learned from him sitting with me and reading the couplets in Urdu and translating them so that I could understand them in English. And I felt that was a huge privilege. And it's because of that, doing that for years, that I was able to, after his death, to edit his work and put it together. But really, it was a huge privilege to learn from and to work with somebody who had, for 30, 40 years, immersed himself in the world of Ghalib.
Yes.
So yes, he really was like Ghalib in many of those ways. And I think that's part of where his huge love for Ghalib and enjoyment came from. He's found so many points of connection. But then, you know, so many of us find points of connection in Ghalib. You don't have to be like him to find it, because he had a very wide understanding. And he could, in a few words, just pinpoint something that you think, oh, yes, that's what I felt. But I think there's a chapter in the book, you asked if there was a reflection in this book. There's a chapter in this book about Ghalib's philosophy. Yes. And there's various headings under which it comes. And one of them is, one way I should say that Ralph was not like Ghalib is that Ghalib was very much an aristocrat and had aristocratic standards of what he expected. And Ralph was very much one of the, felt himself to be one of the common people and had a great interest in anybody regardless of their status in life.
Yes, yes.
So I think they would have disagreed if they'd met on those sorts of things, but more or less only on that, I think. The thing that I think the heading in the chapter on Ghalib's philosophy, the ones that I think are closest, first of all, one is living intensely. Ghalib talks about the zest of life.
Yes.
That this thing about her life, love gives an intensity to life. That,
yes, yes.
That you live intensely, you feel everything intensely. And
ishq ne ghalib nikamma kar diya, warna hum bhi aadmi the kaam ke.
Yeah, it's just the English of love taught my nature what it is to know the zest of life. I found a cure for sorrow in a sorrow without cure. I mean, love taught my nature what it is to know the zest of life. Ralph could have said that totally for himself. And I think the first couplet that is translated in this book, they come in the order of the divan, so it's not Ralph's choice of order. But the very first one is from the one which starts Sirapa rehne ishq o naguzire ulfate hasti, which Ralph has translated, I pledge myself entire to love, and love of life possesses me. I worship lightning and lament the lightning's handiwork.
Yes.
That at the same time you worship lightning, which is this blaze of light, but which also causes destruction. You recognize that there is destruction and horror in life, but you have this intense involvement in life. And that really was Ralph.
Mm-hmm.
He used to say that that Urdu poetry has this real strong tendency to exaggerate. that you say hazaron khaisheng. You don't just say, I want something. You say, I have a thousand longings. And he used to say that that he had found his own soul in that Urdu poetry tendency to. He always exaggerated tremendously. He would underline things 5 times.
Yes. So it is obvious that this book is for people who may be curious as to why and how Ghalib could inspire, you know, generations of poetry lovers. Particularly the use of symbolism in Ghalib's poetry, as Rana pointed out, is always very intriguing and challenges you to come to his level, to have that universal experience of life and times that he lived through. So perhaps Rana Safavi may tell us why this book has a magnetic pull at our hearts.
The symbolism of Farsi and Urdu poetry is well known. We know that when we are talking about the lover and the beloved, there are two levels of love, ishq-e haqiqi and ishq-e majazi, and both are used, the metaphysical as well as the physical love, they are both used on various planes. That is well known, that when we are talking about the saqi or the cupbearer, when we are talking of the tavern or the Mehkhana, we are in some way or other talking of divine love and a conduit to union with the divine. But what I found very fascinating in the book is that Ralph Russell has explained many other images and symbols also. And the one that is my favorite, which I would like to read here, is Tu aur araishe khame kakul mein andesh hai duro daraz. You and the coiling tresses of your hair, I and my endless dark imaginings. Now, again, gesu, kakul, hair, that's a very well-known trope for, the bonds that tie us to the physical life. So here on one level, it's the hair is, a bond between the lover and the beloved. It is also a reference to the bonds that tie us to the physical world. And when Ghalib talks about main aur andesh hai dur o daraz. Now these longings, as Ralph has translated them, endless dark imaginings, these are so relevant today. The worries that we have. So it's not only desire which is binding him to the beloved, but it's also a long dark night of separation. These are also connected to the anxiety, to fear, and again the culture and the time in which Ghalib was writing, hair is something that is covered. So when you are talking about your beloved's hair, it means you have seen it, which again intimates an intimacy.
Yes.
And that intimacy and that sensuality that comes out in this particular verse is brought out beautifully in the book. And so that is why I chose this particular image. Although, as I said, there are so many, which so again, many. The book explains beautifully.
Yes.
This one that gripped me the most.
Yeah. The best part of Ralph Russell's inspiring story is that he was a pakka Angrez for us. I mean, and Marianne said that he was not from aristocracy. Ghalib was also a working man, I mean, for all practical, purposes. He was a salaried person working in, Lal Qila. So for Indians, the whole British, population is part of aristocracy because they were, our bosses, they were rulers. So best part of Ralph Russell's inspiring story is that he was a pakka Angrez who never heard a word of Urdu until he translated, until he, started his, journey as an army officer. And I was reading in his, autobiography that, he was, nearing the Cape of Good Hope when he started, getting lectures about Urdu. So Marianne also, belonged to that area. She was born in South Africa. So there's a, remote connection there also. And when Ralph was coming to India as a officer of World War, as an army person, and he overcame so many barriers and he became eventually a well-respected, you know, Ghalib scholar, and devoted much of his life teaching Ghalib and his language. So Marian, Ralph used to have a very dominant and personal tone in his work. Please tell us whether in this particular book, in this latest book, that personal tone is still there, and if so, how you retained it?
Yes, it's very interesting. I mean, this again was a huge privilege that while Ralph was alive, I knew him for the last 26 years of his life. I learned from him, but then I found he had all these wonderful articles that he'd written in remote journals over the years, and you couldn't easily get them. So I worked with him from the beginning to edit them and get them published in books. So that's while he was living, I was doing that. But towards the end of his life, he said he really knew he'd run out of energy for doing another big project. He's mentally brilliant until his last days and full of life and love until his last days, but the effort to edit another book was not there. And he really wanted Ghalib's, all the different things he'd written about Ghalib, he wanted them put together in one book. So he entrusted me with that task. Mm-hmm. So basically everything in that book is written by Ralph, but what I have done is, so it's all his voice, all his personality is there. Mm-hmm. But what I've done is I've taken all the bits and pieces from articles written over 30 years, and I've organized them as he asked me to under topic, so that he might have written three different articles for three different purposes, which all might have mentioned symbolism, whatever. Mm-hmm. And he wanted to take them so that there would be one section on Ghalib's use of symbolism and one section on his attitude to, you know, love or divine love or whatever. Mm. So it was a cut and paste job from all these different published and unpublished sources, taking everything on one topic and then putting it together. And, you know, I was so immersed by then in his voice. It was his words on all of these different pieces of paper. And then I would choose the strongest expression of that particular idea and put it there. But it is his voice all the way through. So his personality is there. And it was a privilege to do that.
Yes.
It was like, you know, I'm a teacher by background and a trainer. And what you do as a trainer is you don't do stuff yourself. You enable other people to do it. You facilitate with other people to express their voices. And that's what I was doing on paper with that book.
Wonderful.
It was a wonderful experience. Actually,
wonderful. Actually, the best part of this book is ease of, you know, reading. The couplets are there, as you are saying. They are in Urdu, in Hindi, and most importantly, in beautiful poetic English. And the translation is so crisp. It is so beautiful and so accurate and so pleasurably, you know, quotable. I would love to read out a few ghazal couplets from here, this book, especially those that link to our recent experience during lockdown and otherwise also. And I'll request Marian to share the translations which are there in this book. And perhaps Rana Safavi may provide another layer of understanding by commenting on them. So Ghalib says, very famously says, Rahiye ab aisi jagha chalkar jahan koi na ho. रहिए अब ऐसी जगह चलकर जहां कोई ना हो हम सुखन कोई ना हो और हम जबां कोई ना हो बेदरो दीवार सा एक घर बनाया चाहिए कोई हम साया ना हो और पासबां कोई ना हो पड़िए अगर बीमार तो कोई ना हो तीमारदार इन ओरिजिनल पीपल से दैट द वर्ड वाज बीमारदार पड़िए अगर बीमार तो कोई न हो बीमारदार और अगर मर जाइए तो नौ हखवा कोई न हो तो दिस इज अवर मोस्ट रीसेंट एक्सपीरियंस द होल यू नो वर्ल्ड एक्सपीरियंस इट सो आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट मारियन टू लेट अस नो हाउ ब्यूटिफुली राल्फ यू नो ट्रांसलेटेड इट
यस आई थिंक दिस इज वन ऑफ माय फेवरेट ट्रांसलेशंस बिकॉज़ इट इज एब्सोल्युटली You know, if you do a word-for-word translation, it usually doesn't sound like poetry in the language you're translating into. But in this one, he managed to be completely accurate.
Yes.
It's quite amazing. Now let me go away and live somewhere where no one else will be, where there is none that knows my tongue, where there is none to speak with me. There, let me build myself a house with, so to say, no doors, no walls, and live there without neighbors and with no one to keep watch for me. If I fall ill, then there should be no one to come and visit me. And if I die, let none be there to weep and wail and mourn for me.
Wow.
You know, this is so exactly apt, as you just mentioned, to the situation that we are in. People who have unfortunately caught the virus, they are alone. Even those who tragically pass away, nobody can come to them. That burial is also in such a way that has to be very, you know, isolated, and the body is not given the, you know, the proper funeral bath, etc., etc., because of the contagion.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Ghalib also lived during a time which had a lot of epidemics and happening.
Yes.
And those were the days of high mortality as well. The uprising of 1857, Ghalib saw not only many of his friends killed, he saw the emperor to whom he had become an ustad, with whom he used to go very often, and even during the siege of Delhi, during the uprising itself, Ghalib had used to go to the court and had even paid another to the Bashar when he was declared the Shahenshah Hindustan. He saw him tried and exiled, and he suffered many, many miseries and saw the city emptying out. He saw his friends go. There's a very beautiful incident described by Ralph in the book, where he talks of that he's hunting for wine, and the student of his, Mahesh Das, comes and gives him some, you know, local brew, which he then writes a verse on. So he did go through a lot of deprivations, including that the small children of Arif, which he was bringing up, that there's no milk for them, there's no food for them. His brother died, and died in very tragic circumstances in the aftermath, after the fall of Delhi. So he would have, you know, understood what exactly we are going through now. And, you know, the world is changing. And that is why Ghalib's poetry is so beautiful, that it resonates and it's timeless. It resonates with everybody, whatever the age, whatever their background, whether they understand Urdu or not, they can read the translations. And Ralph was perfectly right. If he had written in English, he would have been the greatest poet of all times.
Yeah.
He was the greatest poet of all time, but he would have been acknowledged as the greatest poet of all time.
And another one, which I like, I mean, so much, and others also, you know, love that couplet, that share, and which applies to the, you know, current situation. Kehte hain, jeete hain, उम्मीद पे लोग कहते हैं जीते हैं उम्मीद पे लोग हमको जीने की भी उम्मीद नहीं हमको जीने की भी उम्मीद नहीं Marian would like to talk about this also, I suppose.
It's so short, so simple. There's not a word in there which a beginner in Urdu wouldn't understand. It's,
yes,
not a complicated word or a complicated concept, but it's so deep as well.
Yes.
In English, they say that it is hope that we all live by. I do not even hope that I shall live.
Wow.
And that way he has hope and life and hope counterposed in two opposite ways in the two lines is quite powerful. They say that it is hope that we all live by.
Mm-hmm.
I do not even hope that I shall live.
Hopelessness, despair, hopelessness.
Yeah.
Another one which is slightly deeper and slightly more complex, which is so lovely here. Nagmahaye gham ko bhi. Nagmahaye gham ko bhi, ae dil, ghanimat janiye. Ve sada ho jayega, ye saaz-e hasti, ek din.
I'm just looking for it.
Yes. It is beautiful. And you know, there's an echo of our very recent experiences. Nagmahaye gham ko bhi ae dil ghanimat janiye.
Yeah.
Be sada ho jayega ye saaz-e hasti ek din.
Yeah. Though it play only strains of grief, my heart, yet you must treasure them. The music of this lute of life will all be stilled one day.
Yes.
For me, this is very powerful. We have people close to us who have died. in this time. And we have somebody very close to us who is very ill at the moment. Mm. And I think for all of us stuck in our homes much more than we normally were, what we've really learned to treasure the love that we have, mm. closeness that we have to people. People are rediscovering friends from long ago and finding them by email and whatever, and realizing that that's really what matters. We have to value the love and the life that we have right now.
And finally, I would like to quote the best share of Tom Alter, our common friend. He used to quote this share always. Na tha kuch to khuda tha, kuch na hota to khuda hota. It's so deep, it's so philosophical, it is so true. Na tha kuch to khuda tha, kuch na hota to khuda hota. Duboya mujhko hone ne, na hota main to kya hota.
When nothing was, then God was there. Had nothing been, God would have been. My being has defeated me. Had I not been, what would have been? Again, it's extraordinary because both in the Urdu and in the English, there's not a complicated word.
Yes.
All the words are simple, but the total impact is so convoluted and yet simple.
Yes.
Rana?
The meaning behind it, the layers, the more you delve into it, the more layers open out for you. And that is the beauty of Ghalib's poetry.
Yeah.
So I think I would like to finish with my favorite verse of his.
Yes.
And, which is something that, when I've been hearing it since I was a child. And again, the meanings open out to you as you grow older. Hazaron khwahish hai aisi ke har khwahish pe dam nikle. Bukhat nikle mere arman.
Just do it again. Say it again, Rana. People like to hear it twice.
Hazaron khwahishein aisi ki har khwahish pe dam nikle, bahut nikle mere arman, marma, lekin phir bhi kam nikle.
So I want to tell you a little story. Oh, I should read it in English first. Sorry.
Yes.
Desires in thousands, each so strong.
Wow.
It takes away my breath anew. Mm-hmm. And many longings were fulfilled. Many, but even so, too few. Mm-hmm. So I want to tell you a little story. 4 years ago, I was speaking at the Lahore Literary Festival.
Yes.
And the panel I was on, they were talking about illicit love. Yes. And of course, this is a concept in Ghazal poetry that that is there at a symbolic level and at a real level as well. Mm-hmm. And it is a concept. It is something that is in one of my novels that I was talking about there. So it just came to me at that moment that this was a perfect example, of that intensity of love which you cannot always realize in real life. So I quoted that poem, and I think. For this audience of about 700 Urdu speakers, the sight of this Sangres, I'm actually quoting Hazaron Khwahishein in Urdu, it was both astonishing and delightful and amusing. But it also, that was that moment where really cultural difference disappears when you find a point in one culture which somebody from any culture can connect with.
And before we conclude today's little interaction, I would like to ask you a personal question. Am I allowed, Marian?
Of course.
By editing Ralph Russell's work, are you paying back something?
Absolutely. I started learning Urdu because I was teaching English to women from India and Pakistan, Bangladesh, who had come to live in Britain as adults and they didn't know English. And in order to have that relationship on an equal basis, I thought if they're learning my language, I want to learn one of their languages. So I started trying to learn, teach myself from a teacher self book and from my friends to learn Hindi. And I was getting a certain way, but not very far. I could read it and I could manage a little, but I felt so much eluded me. And then I met Ralph and I realized he was such an exceptional teacher. And I said, would he teach me? He said, if I switch, he said, Yes, he could, but I should switch to Urdu because he could teach me Urdu much better than Hindi. So I switched to Urdu, and then I had once a week classes with him for years and years. And really, it opened up to me a whole different world that I would never have known before. I knew in principle I needed to meet the learners of English on their own cultural basis, that we should meet as equals in that teaching situation, but I didn't know what I would discover from it. Yes. And you know, Ralph used to say the same. He used to say that the discovery of Urdu poetry had brought to him immense riches in life, which he could never repay. And his way of repaying it was to try to introduce it to an English-speaking world.
And it is obvious that it provided a depth to your work also. I was just seeing the novel, the Tajikistan novel, in which you have a character, Rahul Khan. I think that character is product of Ralph Russell's love for Urdu poetry. Who plays that character in Tajikistan? Yes, so it was wonderful.
Yes, I know. It could never have occurred to me in 100 years if it had, yes, I hadn't had this experience of learning, yes, Urdu, and not just learning Urdu, but discovering how passionate so many people are about Urdu poetry. That it is a cultural phenomenon. Really, it is. You know, in England, people know about Shakespeare, but lots of people learn it and study it and think that he's great. But the number of people who know Urdu poetry by heart or who go to poetry recitals is a very small proportion of the population. And yes, in Urdu-speaking society, it is something so vibrant. So it was that discovery that created that character in my novel as well.
Wonderful.
This is the book, huh?
Yes.
Certain Light, yes.
Yes. Wonderful, wonderful. And so with this, we conclude our sweet little discussion about the famous Ghalib, the sound of my moving pen. Ghalib, sarire khama nawaye sarosh hai. Roli Pulse was brought to you by Roli Books.